This program is a tribute to Miriam Colon and to Patricia Bosworth. They both passed on, but they leave their legacy, their love, their art, their happiness, and therefore we cherish their memory. Miriam left us in 2017, and Patricia left us recently in 2020. Patricia Bosworth delivers a tale of family, marriage, tragedy, Broadway, and art, featuring a rich cast of well-known literary and theatrical figures from a golden era, New York, in the 1950s. Patricia and her soulmate, her brother, Bart Jr., were born into privilege in San Francisco as the children of famous attorney Bartley Crum and novelist Gertrude Bosworth Crum. They led charmed lives until their father's career is ruined when he defends the Hollywood 10. The family suffers a tragedy when Bart Jr. commits suicide. In the wake of her brother's death, Patricia makes a life for herself in the glamorous art world of New York City, married and divorced from an abusive husband before she's 20. She joins the Actor Studio, where she takes classes with Lee Strasberg, alongside Marilyn Monroe, Paul Newman, and others. She works on Broadway and also in films. Full of fascinating, never-before-told tales and deep insight, The Man in My Life is a beautifully rendered and engaging account by an insider who defied repression, a story about survival, achieving your goals, and learning to love. Patricia passed away at the age of 86 on April 2nd, 2020, in New York City, victim of the coronavirus. The Actors Studio is a membership organization for professional actors, theater directors, and playwrights at 432 West 44th Street. Actress, journalist, and author Patricia Bosworth produced a wonderful tribute to her late friend and colleague, the legendary Miriam Colon, at the Actors Studio in partnership with Rosalba Rolón and the Pregones Puerto Rican Traveling Theater. I had the pleasure of meeting Miriam Colon and working for Miriam Colon at the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater in the 80s. I did Paper Flowers, Flores de Papel. She was a lady. She was a great performer. And she was a very powerful director. Miriam began her career in the early 50s. She started performing on Broadway, later moving into television. She was perhaps best known for her role as Mama Montana in the 1983 film Scarface. In 2014, Miriam received the National Medal of Arts from President Barack Obama. In 1978, I interviewed Miriam Colon for Spanish radio. And the last time I interviewed her was in 2016. At the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater offices. Here is part of the interview.
Miriam Colon, cuando yo te vi recibiendo ese prestigioso reconocimiento del presidente Obama, pensé que todos nosotros los estábamos recibiendo. Cada latino y no latino que lucha por las artes, que le lleva alegría al mundo, que le ensalza su vida con entretenimiento. Ese eres tú, te lo mereces, no por hoy ni por ayer, por hace mucho, mucho, mucho tiempo que tú empezaste con un sueño, primero de actriz, lo lograste, después de productora, y tu teatro que le ha llevado al pueblo las obras seleccionadas por ti para alegrarlos y enseñarles. Te felicito. ¿Cómo te sientes?
Me siento feliz de estar aquí y de verte, Gilda. Gilda, qué alegría verte de nuevo. Y que aprecies el esfuerzo que uno ha hecho y los logros que uno ha tenido. Es increíble que a veces uno pasa con tanta prisa de un episodio a otro. Y cuando uno ve la reacción que hay a un pequeño triunfo de uno y ve cómo la gente se emociona, se impresiona y hasta se acobarda uno, porque uno no sueña que la gente le va a dar tanta importancia y le va a alegrar tanto ese logro y ese reconocimiento que aprecio de todo corazón.
Patricia Bosworth was born in San Francisco. She is a contributing editor at Vanity Fair and lives in New York City. Patricia has taught literary nonfiction at Columbia University and Barnard College and is a winner of the Front Page Award. A longtime board member of the Actors Studio, she ran the Playwrights Directors Unit there. Her first memoir, Anything Your Little Heart Desires, An American Family Story, was about her family and the Hollywood blacklist. She is also the author of best-selling biographies of Montgomery Clift, Marlon Brando, Jane Fonda, and the photographer Deanne Arbus. Her Arbus biography inspired the 2006 film Fur, starring Nicole Kidman and Robert Downey Jr.
Success, what do you feel?
I feel exultant. I feel Miriam, the long spirit, is right here in the studio. It went beyond my wildest dreams, the tribute to her, because everybody here spoke about her in different amazing ways. She was a force of nature. She was an icon. She was a heroine to her people.
How many years did you...
I knew her for over 40 years because I worked with her at the Actors Studio as a member of the board of the studio. And then I watched her work at the theater, at the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater. So I was there when she was in action, on the street.
But you're also an actor, aren't you?
I was an actor, yeah. Maybe I suppose I still am. I don't know.
And now you're a writer.
I am a writer. I'm a biographer.
And your book is out.
My book is out called The Men in My Life.
I wanted to know a little more about Patricia. So I called her, and she was so kind to give me an interview. Here it is.
Patricia Bosworth, I am so impressed with your life. Not only because you're a journalist, biographer, actress, faculty member of Columbia University, because you were winner Front Page Award, editor of Vanity Fair, you've been on Broadway, actor studio member, TV series, movies. Your life is so fantastic. God bless you. I want to congratulate you.
Well, thank you very much. I just basically had to earn my own living.
And you know what? There's so much emotion and feeling. You've suffered a lot, according to what I've read. And now you've just released a memoir.
Mm-hmm.
And
yes.
The Men in My Life. And this is something that struck me very, very much. You said your brother was your soulmate. Is that correct?
Oh, yes, he was. Yeah, I mean, the book is about him, and the men in my life are my brother and my father, both of whom committed suicide before I was 26. But
oh my God.
Yes, I would have to say my brother was the closest person to me in my life.
How wonderful to feel that with a brother. I feel the same way.
Oh, I know. I think I've created, in a way, I've been married three times, and my first marriage was not good, but my second and third were wonderful, and I always felt they were very much like my brother in temperament, you know, their spirits.
Oh, how wonderful. I'm glad you mentioned spirit, because your spirit is glowing. You have achieved so much, and you've worked also, I saw, with preventive suicide. You try to help
yes.
other people. Tell me about that.
Well, it was actually a very meaningful experience for both me and Judy Collins, as a matter of fact, the folk singer whose son committed suicide. Judy and I bonded over that, of course, over our mutual suicides, which happens when you're a suicide survivor. You connect with other suicide survivors. But in any event, Judy and I were asked by a suicide prevention group to go around the country talking to suicide survivors, listening to their stories, trying to give them comfort and aid. And it was, oh boy, it was unbelievably intense. We did it for almost a year. I must tell you this story because it connects definitely with Miriam, who I loved and admired very much. I worked with single mothers at Covenant House, young, you know, teenage mothers.
Yes.
Girls on the street who had had children, et cetera. And I befriended and actually became the kind of a adoptive mother to this girl named Magdalia Perez.
Yes.
She was 14 years old. She'd already had her first child, didn't know what to do. I helped her, encouraged her to finish high school, and then I wanted her to get a job. And I thought of Miriam because, by the way, this girl was Puerto Rico. She was Puerto Rican.
Yes.
She was from San Juan. And so I brought her to Miriam, and Miriam hired her at the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater, kept her for an entire year as one of her assistants, and during that time, she was very tough on her, very hard on her, wanting her to go on to college, and she emphasized the fact that Magdalia should learn how to speak beautiful English and Spanish. She should always be bilingual. It was going to really help her, and Magdalia is a very bright woman. She took Miriam's advice. She absolutely adored her, worked with her for a year, ended up going to college, graduating from college, and, you know, took her 10 years. But the point of my story is this. Because she learned to speak beautiful English and Spanish, she is now working for the government using her Spanish and English, and she works for the Census Bureau. And she goes
all
over the country.
What a beautiful story of sharing.
Don't you think
giving.
That's fantastic? She
that
never forgot Miriam, ever.
How did you meet Miriam Colon? How did you meet Miriam?
I met her because I wrote about her, which I think I tell the story. I met her, but I'd known her before that. I'd known her at the studio. We were both members of the studio. And then in 1970, 71, the Times asked me to cover Miriam just after she started the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater. So she
uh-huh.
asked me to follow her around during one of the days when she was bringing the theater into
oh,
the barrio.
Oh, that's right. You spoke about that. When they
I
were
did,
the
I did.
Street.
And,
yes,
and I saw her, you know, she was just amazing
yes.
on every level. She wasn't performing that day, although she did indeed perform. An amazing day with her, and I did write about it in the Times. And oddly enough, it was they still have the piece in the, you know, in the archive that you can get it very easily, which just means they think it's important, that she is
yes.
important. I just documented this particular day when she was going around with the troupe and performing in various neighborhoods, and how particularly the kids would follow her from neighborhood to neighborhood, and some of them had even learned the lines, and some
that's
of them would
right,
even get up
right.
on the stage.
You said that she, a lot of people that did, the poor people, the people that didn't
yes.
have the funds or weren't able to go to the theater, she brought the theater to their block.
She absolutely did, and then of course raised a great deal of money with Mayor Lindsay, with the mayor at the time, mayor's task force. Then she went to beyond city government, state, and national funding to get funding for the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater.
But she was a fighter. She was a fighter.
She was
That's
a fighter.
True.
Absolutely. Yes.
Yes.
Very, very much so.
I interviewed Miriam Colon the first time in 1978 for radio. The Spanish radio. I interviewed her again 2.5 years ago, and she told me how much she worked. She was poor. Her mother worked
a lot. Oh, yeah, sure.
She had to,
yes.
in order to go to the university to study drama in San Juan, mm-hmm. Puerto Rico. How she mm-hmm. started in New York, how Rafaelito Campos helped her to get into a play, mm-hmm. and then when she went to Hollywood. The whole struggle that you know so well, because
yes, of course.
I understand that in your book, your latest book, you speak about the 60s and the 70s and the 50s, about the struggles of the young performers. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah. I mean, and also the whole business of being a woman in the
yes.
business, where you
yes.
have to fight against sexism and
yes.
abuse.
Patricia, tell me something. When
yeah.
I saw you at the tribute, I saw how much you put love into everything. There's a lot of meaning, a lot of spirit, and I did feel Miriam Colon's spirit present.
Oh, I did too. Oh, I did definitely. Oh, yeah. I sure did.
Isn't that wonderful?
No, you're absolutely right. Well, you know, the spirits, the ghosts of many people are in that building, in the
yes,
actor studio.
You're in the actor
Marilyn
studio.
Monroe,
tell me
Brando,
about that.
They're all there. They're all floating around. It's,
yes.
It's really quite, I love that space, don't you? The,
I
the
do.
The theater is just.
And you've been there forever. I mean,
I have been there. See, I've been there for 50 years. I started there when I got into the studio when I was 20 years old.
I know that you played, and I must say this, in The Nun Story with Audrey Hepburn. How was
yes,
that experience?
Oh, it was wonderful. I mean, Audrey was the most beguiling, enchanting woman. But she also was a very, very serious woman, as you know. You know, she became, worked with pre-UNESCO and with
yes.
refugees. But
yes.
she was a very decent, good woman, a very kind woman. She was absolutely gorgeous. But she really didn't care about being a movie star. She didn't really like being a movie star. She didn't like the attention.
Patricia, tell me about The Men in My Life. What's going on? It was just released. Give me an update on that.
Oh, the Men in My Life is I take a 10-year period of my life where everything seemed to be happening to me, literally. I take from 1953 to 63, where I get married and divorced, I graduate from college, I get into the actor's studio, I become an actress on Broadway, I go into television and the movies, and then I leave acting and become a journalist. In this 10-year period, everything seemed to happen to me. Plus, which I think is sort of interesting, I met in this period every single person I wrote about. I met Montgomery Clift, the actor, because my father was his lawyer. I met him when I was 15. I got to know him. I met Brando at the actor's studio. I met Deanne Arbus, the photographer, because I modeled for her when I was a teenager.
Beautiful
and
model.
She, too, you know, I never forgot her. And I also met Jane Fonda, who I wrote a mammoth biography of.
That's amazing that you were able to get her, because she did confide in you, and she allowed you to look into her life, her private life.
Yes, she did. Well, of course, we had this real bond. She is a suicide survivor herself. Her mother committed suicide by slitting her throat. Jane was 12. And Jane, of course, was deeply affected by it. When she found out that I, too, had had suicides in my family, it was a real bond between us, and she was much more open with me than I think she might have been if I hadn't been a suicide survivor. Also, she wanted a woman to write about her.
Of
she
course.
Had nine biographies written by men, and they all had felt threatened by her. And she wanted to have a woman write about her because she felt that I would understand her better.
Now, you write in your most recent memoir, again, The Men in My Life, about after your first marriage, your second marriage, and then your third marriage, correct?
Well, I don't write about my third marriage. I only write about two marriages. I mean, I write about this bad first marriage where my husband tried to abuse me and threatened to kill me and everything, to my second marriage, to Mel Origi, who is a playwright and novelist who I love very much. He died of emphysema. I end with my marriage to him, and he died in 86, and then later I married my third husband. This is not in my book. I married my third husband, Tom Palumbo, who was a photographer. Actually, I'm going to be publishing a book of his photographs in February of this coming year.
How wonderful.
But
he died.
He died in 2008.
Hmm? You never stop working.
No, because I have to earn my living. I'm a freelancer. I think, you know, when you're a freelancer, when you're an artist, and I've always believed in wearing more than one hat.
Yes.
So,
yes,
you know, I write, I act, I
yes.
direct, whatever. Well, I have another man in my life right now. I have a companion.
God bless you.
Yes, I know.
Well, you're a good-looking woman. You have to have
well,
that.
Well, maybe, but I'm an old lady now, or I'm getting old, you know. No, I have a wonderful companion who we knew each other when we were very young, and we both married other people, and then we got together a couple of years ago, and he did run a music agency for classical musicians, and he also ran a theater at Harvard. He's a very cultivated man, and I see him on weekends.
Well, you know what? That's quality time, Patricia, isn't it?
It is quality time. So we go on trips together, and it's very nice.
Before we part, your father was very important in
yes,
helping
he was.
A lot
he
of
was
people
Crum.
In
he
Hollywood.
He defended one of the lawyers who defended the Hollywood 10 during the blacklist. These were writers and directors who were accused of being communists, and a couple of them went to jail. And of course, it was against the law to be persecuted for your political beliefs. This
yes.
is what my father believed, and it is true. You know, it's
he worked for
Bobby Kennedy too, as a matter of fact. When Kennedy
God.
Was investigating the corruption within the Teamsters Union.
He was a fighter also like you. You're like your dad.
Oh, God, yes. Oh, my God. Oh, definitely.
Well,
oh, yes.
Well, listen, darling, I want to thank you. It's a pleasure. And I just want to give me some advice for the young people, if we have some listening or hearing or watching.
Oh, well, you just, if you want to do something, you really do have to work at it. You have to show up. You have to be on time if you're, doing
yes.
a job. You really have to be disciplined in order to accomplish anything. You really do have to work very hard. I believe that.
And how do you remember, again, Miriam Colon? Tell me how you remember her.
I remember Miriam as a remarkable human being, a tough, courageous woman who had very high standards, who believed totally in theater and the magic of theater, the healing qualities of theater, and was determined to bring them to everybody. She felt that the theater belonged to everybody, and I think that was part of her philosophy.
That's right. Thank you, Patricia. God bless you. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Miriam Colon Valle. Thank you, Patricia Bosworth.